These are two Sony CPD-G520P Trinitron CRT monitors which I found sitting half submerged in a container today, and I did not hesitate to pull them out. To those who aren't quite initiated with the whole Sony CRT thing, these are basically the 4:3 aspect ratio brothers of the famous FW900 CRT monitor, which can still be sold for outrageous prices in good nick. And I figured it would be very well worth our time trying to get at least one of these guys up and running, especially since we've got two identical ones seemingly sold at the same time, so we've got plenty of spare parts to go around. So some quick specs on them: they are 21-inch about 20-inch visible, and they can do resolutions of up to 1800 by 1440 at 85 Hz, and probably lower resolutions at ridiculous refresh rates, which is nice if you're gaming. And they of course have the famous Sony Trinitron tubes, which have a rather a different aperture grille than the more traditional CRTs like the Barco monitors, which I use in everyday production. Supposedly, Sony Trinitrons appear a lot subjectively sharper than other monitors do, and of course these are flat panel CRTs, they don't have the traditional CRT curvature to them. So it's if we can get one of these running, or perhaps even both, it's going to be very interesting comparing these to my Barco monitors, since the Barco monitors are similar age, but they are way more expensive monitors. I'm quite curious to see how these roughly $1,500 monitors would compare to the roughly $10,000 Barcos. Especially since today we've got access to a neutral calibrating tool like my Spider 4, whereas the Barco actually shipped with its own calibrator, no doubt making up a lot of its additional cost. But enough about the Barcos, let's get one of these guys apart, and I think we're gonna take this one, because I believe that one was lying upside down in the container, and I think someone just chucked it in there, and it received quite the bang. I think this one was just neatly placed on top of it, so I think this one's gonna be in better mechanical nick. But they are both very worn out, that one smells like piss and beer, so I'm expecting obviously some water intrusion, since they've been lying outside in a puddle in the rain, and I'm not expecting everything to have stayed in place if they've just been chucked in the container with no care taken whatsoever. And just give this one a bit of a wipe down, and before we fold it on its face and take a look at the insides, I figured we'd have a look at the legendary Trinitron grill. So I'm zoomed in as close as I can get to this monitor, and here's a ballpoint pen for size reference, and you can see that this is an absolutely super fine grill. There she comes. And if that's not a Terminator with its skin melted off, I don't know what is. That's lovely. No need for the fan cooling that the Barco has. And there's the inside with some giant heat sinks and driver stuff, and of course the giant high voltage transformer and tube wire. And this does look like a rather low hours unit actually, because we don't have huge amounts of statically attracted dust everywhere. In fact, it's looking really, really clean for one of these. So I'm having some high hopes as to this being the perhaps being rather serviceable still. Nothing seems to have been coming loose from abuse. The entire choke assembly is still firmly attached to the tube. The end cap is still there. Everything's looking rather fine. Right, I've now taken some time to take the monitor outside, give it a thorough blowjob. I've cleaned it up quite a bit, just rubbing all the dirt and crap out of it, and I've given it a brief inspection of the solder joints through the ventilation holes under the chassis, and everything actually looks very clean. And in fact, I'm so confident in this thing now that I've plugged it in, and all I need to do is flick two switches and we'll see if this thing is alive. So brace yourself, here goes the main switch. There goes nothing. green LED. That sounds lovely. We should have a signal. Hey, there we go. So the settings are absolutely awfully wrong. Absolutely disgustingly awfully wrong. But we are getting picture. It seems to be sharp enough. And I think we can fix this by fiddling with the settings. Alright, I've been messing around with this thing for a while now, and it's becoming apparent that something is wrong with it, because it has absolutely awful contrast ratio, and the geometry won't get properly corrected no matter what you do. So this one's gonna need some additional servicing in order to become a proper monitor again. If it's due to some transport damage or water intrusion or what have you, I can't say for sure, but we'll save any further investigation until we've tested the other one, in case that one works just fine, and we'll just keep this one as a spare parts monitor. The tube seems to be in good order. If I mangle the settings enough, I can get some pretty good blacks out, but I just can't get the contrast ratio. But all the settings, a vast majority of them anyway, seem to be doing stuff with to the signal digital and some DSP kind of thing, so it's a bit difficult knowing which setting is actually affecting tube drive and which isn't. Alright, and I've now dried up and fired up the other one as well, and as you can see, these monitors clearly have some rather severe image quality issues. So I've set these to this same exact setting, same color temperature, same brightness and contrast, and indeed I've factory reset them as well. The only thing I've changed is I've made the actual computer image rather small to demonstrate the issue, because that's supposed to be black and the same colors on both of them, which is rather obviously not anywhere near the case. So I have done some research on this issue, and it seems that plenty of Sony and Sony rebranded monitors of this era suffer from an issue where they will just get brighter and brighter over time, and there are a couple of ways to remedy this. One is by changing a couple of resistors in hardware, and another one is by using some Sony software to recalibrate the RGB amplifier in the monitor. The sad thing is 90% of all the fixes I've been able to find are for the previous generation of the monitor, the G500, whereas these G520s should use a similar electronic design but very different physical layout of the PCBs inside, making the very easy to access components in the older monitor very difficult to access in this particular one. So I've managed to get my hands on this special Sony software required to recalibrate these monitors, and I do believe I've even got the appropriate wiring to hook them up to a computer. So I figured we'd give it a go on perhaps this one, since this seems to be the crappier of the two. What's not obvious with this one is that it's got some rather severe geometry issues, which I can't seem to quite remedy in the OSD. Despite the rather advanced geometry controls available, it seems the entire picture is kind of wider in that end than it is in this end, so this might have actually been the one which was thrown into the dumpster, and it's just kind of banged the picture tube and the main things on it, so that the electron guns or what have you just aren't really properly aligned anymore. But this one's got excellent geometry, it's just got the brightness issue, and it's got a less severe brightness issue at that, so that one's probably the keeper if we can get to just one of these running. Of course it's nice if we can get both, but let's try and get the software up and running on an old laptop and see what we can get from there. Right, and here's the S end of the monitor we're gonna be trying to fix, and right here is the serial port. So this is a 5 volt level serial port, which you have to connect either up to a max 232 or one of these USB TTL 5 volt level adapters. And obviously that's what I'm going to use, since I don't have any TTL board ready to go. So let's make an adapter and see if it works. And there we go, there's our adapter. I've chosen to solder it into the monitor, since I don't actually have any connector which fits properly on that. A normal pin header won't do it, since the pins are too wide. This should be ready to go. I've connected TX and RX accordingly, and a ground as well. There is a 5V connector on the monitor, which I have not connected, even though I've got it ready to go in case it's needed. I'm not sure if that's an output or an input on the monitor. If it's an input, it's going to be needed to power the serial port circuitry in there, but I think we will not be requiring to connect that in order to get this work, but we'll find out. Alright, so now we get our prerequisite Windows XP laptop set up with the adapter installed and everything connected up to the monitor. This is the software I'll try to keep a link in it in the description somewhere. It was rather hard to find. And if all is right, all we have to do is power on the monitor and run that application there. So let's see what it does. That's supposed to happen. Alright, so after some mucking about, we had to enter the ActiveX folder and then run a bat file. We can now choose our model, so let's see. Oh, hello, we've actually got the CPD-G520P proper there. So let's see what it does. Alright, after some mucking about and have a program crash a few times and then doing nothing to fix it, we've now got this magical screen, which supposedly lets us back up the config from the monitor. So let's try it out. Supposedly the monitor might black out while doing this, so we will see. And the monitor did black out, so we've definitely got some working communication, and if I'm looking at my serial adapter now, we've got something going on the TX and RX pins. So we are actually communicating with the monitor, that's fantastic. So perhaps we can even get this thing to work properly without doing any hardware mod at all. That's the sound of a monitor waking back to life. And I think we've got our file now. Alright, so with our file saved, we should now be able to go to Expert there and view our saved file. Let's see. Fact 3. So we're looking for a value called G2. And it's going to be around here somewhere. Ah, there we have it, at the top of reg 8.1. This monitor seems to have a slightly different syntax than the one used in the guide I'm checking, which, as everything else, is for the older version of this stuff. But this is seems to be the value we're looking for. It's the only G2-related thing I've been able to find. So, what we want to do with this thing is adjust it down a bit. Supposedly, this is the gain for the RGB cannons, or some kind of reference voltage for something, and when this is too high, it makes everything too bright. Now, you cannot edit this in the Windas software, so we'll just give away from there to unlock our file. And I've brought it out in a hex editor. And you cannot search for the individual name, but you can search for a value. And if I search for 160, we find ourselves right at the top of reg 8.1 there. And the first value is indeed 160, and there are no other hits in this file. So I would be rather confident to believe that this is the value we want to change. So let's give it a rather significant change and see. If we can actually make the monitor perform as expected. So let's put this at like 130. Let's save the file. And then we're going back to Windas and we can load data to set. We choose our new file. And when we press go, we should be writing some data to our monitor. Alright, the moment of truth is upon us. That doesn't look considerably better to me than I do not know what does. Excellent. So, it's important to press OK in this apparently, because else you'll lock your OSD. And now, we should have a much more workable monitor. Let's check it out a bit closer. Alright, so this is what our monitor looks like now, and that is looking so much better in so many ways. It seems as if, just to my naked eye, we have even sorted out some of the geometry issues, which I suppose you might expect to appear if you're overdriving everything as harsh as this monitor was. However, we can still see that we've got a bit of an overly bright edge to that black image, despite our settings being pretty much factory standard with a brightness set to 50. And if we turn that down to somewhere around that, 30, 35, we'll see that it starts to disappear. So we probably want to bring the value down a bit more, because if we turn the brightness up to 100, the monitor is just absolutely stupidly overly bright still. So let's adjust that down to like 100 flat and see what we can get, because this seems to just adjust the range you get on the brightness control basically. Because I don't see any obvious distortion being caused by this. In fact, this monitor looks quite well if I just adjust it down to 30 or so in brightness. Alright, so I've really gone off the deep end of this. I've just finished reading a 45-page thread from the mid-2000s on these monitors and all the issues they might encounter, and I've been collecting pages upon pages of test data with my Spider 4 on this thing while changing various parameters in the firmware through the Sony software. In essence, I've gotten this one relatively good by messing around with it, but the worst issue it's got is that it's got way too much gamma. While I've got it set as good as I've managed thus far, it refuses to go below about 2.9, which is just ridiculous for a CRT. Also, the colors obviously horrible. In fact, on both of these, they are very purple-ish. But there are facilities in the software to compensate for that. However, there's one facility which we're going to run on this thing, which has been heating up for a very long time now, which seems to be doing something which isn't available in the software, and that is image restoration. The consensus on this thing is that it changes something which you don't see in the files you get out of a monitor, so it's doing some weird magic inside of some chip somewhere inside of a device, and this has apparently it's got an ability to fix a lot of stuff. It also changes some stuff in the EEPROM data, but let's run this thing and see what it does. So they're displaying a 50% grey at the moment, and that's looking an awful lot better. And now it's like shit again. That looked good, excellent for a second. Perhaps this will be better. I haven't done any changes to this thing whatsoever, so it's still got the default values for everything. I wonder if this one doesn't look quite good right now, actually. So what's the verdict? It's a bit too bright still, but it's nowhere near as bad as it was. Yeah, this is going to perform relatively well right now. This one was also, as you remember, way too bright even with the brightness set to zero. Now it's at 30, and you're not going to see it, but that's almost black to me. So I think we need to stick the Spider 4 on this guy and see how it manages. I'm almost tempted to run the image restoration once again to see if it'll actually adjust the G2 voltage down further, because it's obviously adjusted the G2 voltage on this thing since we had lost the horrible white issue. Yeah, let's do it. So now we've got it at 25% brightness and it's black. Let's see if we can get some better performance still. Yes, indeed, that has improved. That has improved considerably. What an odd feature. And all the mucking about I've done on this thing hasn't been able to create such good results. So, let's performance check this guy. And would you look at that? That is not a very good result. We've got a rather unimpressive black level coming out of that, but the gamma is almost okay, and the quality of the output to picture is miles ahead of the other one, and those values are almost good. So, I guess I'm going to have to wait for the other one to actually run continuously for long enough to do a picture restoration upon it as well, where I've actually already adjusted down the G2 value manually, and perhaps we can see some more impressive results out of that one as well. are also finally waiting for the right monitor to warm up, and you can quite clearly see the difference between the one which have the restoration done to it and the one I've just messed with, and the relatively well-tuned LCD in the background there. So let's give this guy the reset treatment and see what happens. So that's obviously a monitor-generated 50% grade shown, because that's covering the entire CRT. And there we're back to the actual computer image, and that's looking way better. It's not identical to that one. It's certainly a major improvement, though. It's, in fact, it's looking quite similar to the LCD there. And going even further off the deep end with this project, I can now present to you one of the most accomplished computer screens I've ever seen. Screens as in this screen. Because I just completed the complete 254 step procedure for adjusting the white balance on this thing. And man oh man, I wouldn't want to be working in the Sony factory making these. This took many an hour and a lot of grinding at super low intensity screens with my not particularly impressive Spider 4 colorimeter. But this monitor actually passed on every single point. It's performing exactly within spec as far as the white balance in the software is concerned, so I guess that's a plus. Lots of things were way out of spec when I started, so with a bit of luck, this thing's going to be performing quite well now. Alright, so as you may be able to tell, I've entirely ruined the convergence of this monitor, and that is for a reason. I was messing about in the software and I got into the convergence adjustment menu and I figured, alright, I'll give it a shot, it's pretty good as it stands, but I can probably make it better. And long story short, it was absolutely spot on, I couldn't get it any better, and I managed to make it significantly worse because it resets the parameters when you enter the adjustment and it writes all the data live to the EEPROM, so you cannot restore it afterwards. Now, fixing this wouldn't have been a big issue if not for the fact that I didn't save a file for the actual super long white balance adjustment I did. So the horrible convergence file got baked in with the perfect color balance file inside the monitor, and that was the only copy of a file in existence. So how I've gone about trying to fix this is I read the file out, which has the right color balance and the wrong convergence, and I then set the convergence to absolutely stupid levels in that file, so that all the values for convergence were set to 255, making them easy to find in a hex editor. So I've now spent the last couple of hours digging through a couple of hex files and finding all the convergence values, and I think I've got a file generated now manually which should contain the convergence data from the monitor from the factory and the color balance data I created a moment ago. And we're going to try loading it in and see what happens. Because if either of these procedures, the color fixing or the convergence fixing, is for naught, then I might as well just restore the monitor to factory and redo the color adjustments, because that would be less of a pain than trying to redo the convergence to similar standard as it had from the factory. So here we go. Here's to hoping. Alright, moment of truth. And that is factory perfect convergence. Whew! And since I'm pretty sure I haven't touched any of the color cal data, that's still gonna be in there. What a relief. And after all that, performance is actually starting to look rather reasonable. So our color temperature with the monitor actually set for 6500K is 6500K enough. The gamma's a bit on the high side, but it could be by design. And everything else is just looking rather good. The DE2K to locus well, Delta 2K to Locus is actually looking rather good, with all the values being below 5 and a couple of them being 0.2, which is just excellent. So, now I'm going to leave this monitor running a full calibration overnight, and tomorrow we're going to have some rather interesting color curves for it. Let's hope it checks out. And I must say, from a purely subjective point of view, this looks just fine. It looks damn well close enough to my other properly calibrated monitors. I've now spent pretty much 2 full days messing with this thing, fine-tuning the colors and running calibrations on it, and I've got some results to show for it. Sadly, they're not very impressive, not very impressive at all, but let's have a look anyway. So here's some of the data gathered when doing a report of a monitor, which is comparing it to a perfect flawless sRGB profile, and basically you're looking for low delta E values, and yeah, we've obviously got absolutely horrible delta E values, and what a delta E value is basically the deviance from the actual color that the displayed color is. So the higher the delta E value, the further from your target you are. And we seem to mostly be having a bit of a gamma issue where the display is just not quite reaching the targeted 2.2 gamma response, which is a bit of a shame. It seems to naturally tend to a beta gamma of 2.5, which is rather ridiculous for a CRT. And also in the color tests, we're seeing absolutely horrendous deviance all over the board. So this monitor is not performing very well at all. For reference, I ran an identical report on my Barco, and I didn't even bother letting it warm up beforehand, because you can clearly see how the cold Barco is performing quite acceptably, whereas the several hours warmed up Sony is just doing an absolutely dreadful job of displaying anything properly. So this Sony is going to need some extra care. I'm going to revisit this in a bit, but right now I want to move on to the second one in case this one's just a dud and the other one's in much better nick. Because I don't want to be spending all my time fixing this thing up if we're just going to end up having to spare parts monitor anyway. Needless to say though, these results are not absolutely dreadful. This is pretty much on par with what you'd see on an a mid-range LCD monitor, except we've got a contrast ratio of about 20,000 to 1. So it's not an entirely lost cause. This monitor would be absolutely fine for everyday use, web browsing, Facebook, gaming, what have you. But I'm into photo and video editing, so I need that precision, which currently only my Barco in this room delivers. So let's just fix the other one and see if it's better.
Boy, oh boy, have I gone down the rabbit hole on this one. So, I present to you the Sony Trinitron Calibration Station, where I've set up specifically for this task a Windows XP computer able to run both the Sony software and HDFR colorimeter and DispCal. It's got its wiring taped down because it's going to be here a while, complete with the elitist keyboard in the house and the most box-standard Lenovo mouse you could ever find sitting on a Bosch high-pressure washer box. So, what's going on is that I have absolutely been going mad with the calibration of this thing. It seems straightforward. It is anything but straightforward, because these monitors do not like to end up at gamma 2.2, which is what everything else uses, and actually getting them to calibrate properly is a major chore, which I haven't quite figured out yet. So I've been recalibrating this thing over and over and over again and never reaching quite proper results. So the last step I've done now is I've moved it here, because little did I consider that half of my bench is held together with magnets, and that's not really proper for a CRT monitor under calibration now, is it? I tried just moving my big speakers up there rather than sitting right on top of the monitors, but yeah, even sitting up there, they seem to actually have a big enough magnetic field to affect the monitor slightly if I turn that one. around, you can actually see the image changing, which isn't the case when it's sitting on the Sony on the bloody Sony Trinitron calibration station there. I have done several calibrations. It's turned out reasonably good in a few of them, but it's always got that horrible gamma. So now I'm going to just try and redo this properly. Yeah, I've got Windas there, and I've got a HCFR colorimeter there. I'm currently measuring through my spider, and the odd thing is, we always have a good delta E on the grayscale. No matter what happens, we've got a good delta E. I can switch to a higher tone of gray, and just because I said so, the delta E's gone through the roof. And over there we go, dropping back down. The spider 4 is a bit blippy on CRT displays. But really, this performance looks pretty good, and no matter what Brosnan set it to. And it's just a bit of a mystery, because when I do a report on it in display cal, it always ends up horrible, and you can see that it's looking horrible. And I'm thinking that's mostly got to do with the fact that it's got this weird, like, 2.6 gamma, which is crushing all the blacks to a barely useful level. And I haven't quite figured that out yet, so I'm going to keep sitting at the bench and tweaking the knobs for another while. And that camera's sitting there because I was using it as a microscope for convergence adjustments. You know what, looking through my footage, I've got like 2 hours of stuff recorded, so I'm just going to cut this into 2 videos, and I might make another video when I actually get this thing properly calibrated. So thank you for watching. Cheerio.